Good morning, my name is Roshna. I am working as assistant professor under library department in St. Martin's Engineering College. Today let me see about the three working principle of three-phase induction motor. Whenever a current carrying conductor is placed in a magnetic field, then the conductor will experience a force. I am repeating again. Whenever the current carrying conductor is placed in a magnetic field, the conductor will experience a force. This is the basic motor principle. Now let me see how a three-phase induction motor will work. And now let me see how the induction name you got for this motor. So every motor basically consists of main two parts, stator and rotor. This is a brief view of your diagram. As the stator, this we consider as a stator, and this is as a rotor. As a rotor, maximum uses of rotor and induction motor is squirrel cage type, because there will be two types of rotors. First one is squirrel cage and second one is slip ring type of rotor. So maximum 90% of industrial uses this squirrel cage type. The name itself indicating what is meant by squirrel. The shape of the rotor will be the form of a squirrel cage. So from this you can know that the rotor is completely of a closed path. Here we can't alternate any rotor parts once it got manufactured and it is seated in the machine. So it is a cage type of construction which is of closed type. This is about the rotor which we are using in a stator. Now let me see the construction of a stator. Here stator consists of three phase winding. Stator we are going to give three-phase AC supply. So once if you give a three-phase AC supply to a three-phase distributed type of winding, which type of magnetic field will get? We will get rotating type of magnetic field. We will get a rotating type of magnetic field. A small concept, nothing but whenever if you pass a current to any conductor, that conductor will experience some magnetic field. The same way, once if you give a three-phase AC supply for a three-phase distributed type of winding, which type of magnetic field do we get? A rotating type of magnetic field we will get. Rotating means, if you see, generally we will design the stator for four poles. So north, south, north and south. So how do the magnetic field will rotate? So first pulse, for first time period, if north and south are in active mode, the next pulse, this north and this south will be active mode. So by looking how do it represents, the poles are moving its position in this way. So that is the reason we are saying that as a rotating magnetic field. Means here, if you are having a four poles, a pair of poles will be active, the other two pair of poles will be inactive mode. Once after next time period, after next half second, then these two will be in active mode. Next, these two will be in active mode. So this is the way how do the magnetic field rotates with the speed of synchronous speed. Synchronous speed. What is the speed of your magnetic field? It is synchronous speed, which is nothing but 120 F by V. So the speed of your rotating magnetic field is depending upon the frequency which you are giving to a three-phase winding and how many number of poles you have designed for a stator winding. So this will decide the speed of your rotating magnetic field, right? So from this you have understood that which type of magnetic field you are producing in a three-phase AC motor, nothing but three-phase induction motor. Now let me see how do this motor name got induction motor. Because as we know that the motor principle itself, whenever a current carrying conductor is placed in a magnetic field. So here I have to place a current carrying conductor in presence of magnetic field. But if you observe here, I am only giving a three-phase AC supply. Nothing but the three-phase AC supply is given to a stator winding only, where it produces a magnetic field. But what about a current carrying conductor? Here I am not giving any current supply directly to the rotor here. Keep that in mind. How we are going to get the current here? By induction principle. So here, what is the induction principle? As we know that whenever here it is an AC, so obviously the magnetic field will always pass from north to south in this way. So it's an AC supply, being it is an alternating type. Whenever the flux line cuts the conductor, keep that in mind. First, I am not giving any kind of supply to the rotor. Starting the rotor position is zero. There is no momentum in your rotor position. Hence, the flux line simply passes through the rotor, through the air gap, through the rotor, then it passes to the other side of the stator south pole. So, when it passes through this, definitely these flux lines, alternating flux lines passing through the rotor, it cuts the rotor bars. Hence, there is an induced EMF in your rotor bars, where this principle we will say as mutual induction principle. Whenever there is an alternating flux passes through any conductor, an EMF is induced. That is the Faraday's law. So, based on this induction principle, we are going to get an induced voltage in this. Now, we have to check what is the direction of your induced voltage. Then only I can know the force. Right? First, now based on the induction principle, I got the current supply through a rotor pass. Being an induced EMF is induced here, I already said rotor is a closed path. So, once there is a closed path and you are having a voltage, current starts separating in your rotor. Now, the motor principle is applicable here. How? Because there is a current carrying conductor is placed in a presence of magnetic field. Now, according to the motor principle, this conductor, nothing but this rotor, will experience some force due to the current carrying conductor placed in a magnetic field. Now let me see the direction of the force. As we know that already, how do we identify the force? Nothing but the direction of force on the rotor with the help of Fleming's left hand rule. Right? Before applying the Fleming's left hand rule, I have to know what is the direction of induced voltage in your rotor bus. Right? So first, find out the induced voltage based on the Faraday's law principle. Nothing but it's a generator. Whenever there is an induced EMF, to identify the direction of induced EMF, we can apply the Fleming's right hand. So first, open your first right hand, all the five fingers. Now stretch the first three fingers perpendicular each other. The first four finger, middle finger and the thumb should be stretched perpendicular to each other. Right? Now see the direction. What is the each and every finger indicates? Now if you see the forefinger indicates the direction of flux. If you see the middle finger indicates the direction of induced EMF. Now your thumb indicates the direction of force. Right? So if you observe here, see from which direction the flux is coming? Up to down. So apply the first finger downward direction. Now you have to know on which side the force is existing. Because out of three, you have to know the two variables. Automatically, the third variable can be determined. Now, if you see, there is a flux direction coming up to down. But what is the force? So, there is a simple example here. Once there is a rotating magnetic field, assume that it is moving in clockwise direction. If any object is moving over the other object, if example, I am walking. So, how do I walk forward direction? By having an opposite force towards, a friction force should be there between myself and the ground. Then only I can move forward. Nothing but an opposite force. When I push backward direction, the force, then only I can move in. Means here, same physics we are applying here. Once the magnetic field is moving in clockwise direction, with respect to the rotor surface, the force with respect to rotor surface is acting opposite. Then only that it can move over the clockwise direction. Right? So the force over the conductor, now I can apply right hand rule. So the field, the flux is moving from top to down. The force is indicated over the rotor, over this side. Hence the induced voltage is towards our side. Nothing but out of dots. If it is into the board, you can indicate with the cross mark. So it is out of the board, I am indicating with the dots. So as we know that what is the flux direction around your conductors according to the right hand thumb. So if you see, it is coming out. So all your four fingers are indicating in this direction. So the resultant flux is this way, like this. This is the flux around your conductor. Now you can see there is a carrying conductor which is placed in a magnetic field. Now let me apply the left hand rule. Right. So they are first three fingers same, perpendicular to each other. All the three fingers, first three fingers should be. The fourth finger will indicate the direction of flux. The middle finger will indicate the direction of current in the conductor. And the thumb indicates the direction of force over a conductor. Now if you see, how do the flux is going? Top to down. What is the current direction? It is out of the board. Then see the force. The force is indicating towards clockwise direction like this. So clockwise. This is the force exerted on the rotor. So there is a small logic if you observe. They are rotating magnetic field also moving in clockwise direction, and the force on the rotor is also exerted on the same clockwise direction. From this, what you can conclude that the rotor direction completely depends upon the direction of the rotor is same as the direction of your rotating magnetic field. What is the rotor direction? The rotor direction is in same direction to your rotating magnetic field. So this is the way how you can check the working principle of an induction motor. So if I recall back the same concept, how do the induction motor work? So because here the current passing through the rotor is not directly given. If the current in the rotor is flown through induction principle, so that is the reason why this motor is called as induction motor. In DC motor it is also called as conduction motor, because in DC motor you are giving two supplies. One is supply given to the magnetic field to produce the magnetic field, and one to pass the current to the rotor bars. But here I am only giving the three phase AC supply to the stator to produce only magnetic field. But the current in the rotor is getting automatically through induction principle. Right? So that is the reason we call the name induction motor. Now you'll get a question. Can I change the direction of the rotor? Yes. How we can change the direction of the rotor? Because if you see the applications of three-phase induction motor, the three-phase induction motor is generally industrial application, and mainly nowadays it is maximum using in vehicles. For electric motors or hybrid motors, maximum we are preferring three-phase induction motor. There, if you see, a car or a vehicle have to move forward and backward direction. So there should be a both direction movement in your rotor. Now if you want to change the direction of the rotor, how do we change? Simple. Here, as we are giving a three-phase AC supply, R by B. Based on this phase sequence, I will get the direction of rotating magnetic field. If you change the phase sequence, I think that if you are not giving R by B, R B by, change the phase sequence, change any two of the phase sequence, then what happens? Automatically, your direction of rotating magnetic field will change. Once the direction of rotating magnetic field is changed, automatically based on the working principle, your rotor position also will change with respect to your rotating magnetic field. So in this way, even you can change the direction of rotating magnetic field. Right? If you next, let me see how do we find the rotor speed. What is meant by slip? First, let me see what is meant by slip speed. Slip speed is nothing but the difference between the rotating magnetic field speed and the rotor speed. Nothing but ns minus nr. What is meant by slip speed? Slip speed is nothing but the difference between the rotating magnetic field speed and the rotor speed. Okay, next. What is meant by percentage? the slip is nothing but it is the ratio of slip speed to the synchronous speed. Nothing but ns minus nr by ns equal 100. In percentage wise, you can calculate the slip. Slip is nothing but it is the ratio of slip speed to the synchronous speed. If it is in percentage means into 100, then you will get in the percentage slip. So this is about your slip speed and the slip. One more, to know the working principle, already we have taken left hand. And there is one more logic where we can prove the rotation direction with Lenz's law. We can know the direction of the rotor not only through Fleming's left hand, even you can identify with the help of Lenz's law. Now, how do we find the direction of the rotor with the help of Lenz's law? What does the Lenz's law say? It opposes the main cause producing it. Lenz's law always states that it opposes the main cause producing it. So here for the rotation of the rotor, what is the main cause here? What is the main cause for the direction of the, nothing but rotor direction? The main cause, if you observe, it is not a three-phase AC supply also. It is the relative difference. What is meant by relative difference? The relative speed variation between the rotating magnetic field speed and the rotor speed. Due to the relative speed difference between, a relative velocity difference between stator rotating magnetic field and rotor speed. That is the main reason. You can ask why this is the main reason for the momentum of the rotor. If you see that basic example, if the difference is not much, as you know that when do the flux wind cuts your conductor bars, then the position of rotor with respect to magnetic field is perpendicular, or it is somewhat inclined with respect to the magnetic field. It should not exactly in parallel. As we know already that if the position of the rotor is in same direction, nothing but it is in parallel mode with respect to magnetic field, if both are moving in the same speed, the flux lines will not cut. The flux lines will not cut. Basically, why do the flux lines are cut here? Because of relative difference. There is an angle inclination between the rotating magnetic field, flux lines and the conductor. Due to this only the EMF has been induced. If there is no angle difference between the rotating magnetic field and the rotor speed, then obviously the flux lines, the rate of flux linkage with respect to your rotor bars will be zero. So same question if you ask, if the rotor reaches the same speed with respect to rotating magnetic field, there will not be any induced EMF. The induced EMF will be zero. Hence, the torque produced in the motor also will be zero, right? So that, what is the main reason? Because the difference, there is a relative motion difference between, already said, the force over your rotor is on opposite direction with the rotating magnet. Because of this difference, we are getting the induced EMF. Then only, because of induced EMF, I got the current flow, then I got the motor current. If not, there is no motor principle will work out in this induction motor. So this is the main reason. What is the main reason? The Lenz's law. So always rotor will try to, Lenz's law is nothing but it will always try to reduce the main cause producing it. What is the main cause I said? The mainly the relative difference between your stator rotating magnetic field speed and the rotor speed. So hence, to reduce that relative difference, the rotor will try to move in which direction? In same direction to rotating magnet. Means rotor will try to move in the parallel with respect to your your stator rotating magnetic field. Now you may get question that if it reaches the same speed, you said it will be zero, then motor will not work now. Yes, but the rotor can't reach, even if you are not applying any load, the full speed of the rotor never reaches the synchronous speed, because this is a magnetic field which doesn't have its own inertia. It is a magnetic field which will change its position with synchronous speed. But if you take the rotor is a huge weighted object, it has its own inertia. That is the main reason. Though if you are not applying any kind of load on the rotor can't reach exactly synchronous speed. Right? Now you understood. So once it reaches, if you can ask if it reaches, yes, there will not be no induced EMF, hence there will not be any torque in your rotor bars. Right? For here you have come, I think you have understood how it will not reach the synchronous speed with respect to rotating magnetic speed. Right? Even when the maximum flux will cut, the main torque, we know that the torque of the motor will always depends on flux, armature current, and the power factor. But here we know that torque is mainly proportional to the current. So if you want to produce the more current, if there is no load on the rotor, what happens? The rotor will try to move its full speed. If it is moving with full speed, which is not exactly, but it will try to go near to the synchronous speed, then what happens? The rate of flux cutting will be less because it is trying to go near to it. So whenever the angle difference between the rotating magnetic field and your rotor is reducing, the rate of flux cutting will reduce. Hence what happens? What the current flow in your rotor bars will reduce, hence you will not have more torque. Right? If current is getting drawn less, obviously the power drawn is also less. So once there is no load, the rotor rotates with high speed, which draws very less current, and hence power drawn by the motor also will be less. Therefore, torque also will be less. If you are applying the load, slowly you are starting applying the load on your shaft of the motor, then what happens? Slowly, that's a basic principle. If you apply the load, the speed will reduce. If speed reduces, means what is happening? The speed of your rotor is getting reduced. It means that the relative difference is getting more. Hence, the flux cutting will be more. If rate of flux cutting is more with respect to a conductor, and EMF induced will be more. Means the current flow, the current flow in the rotor bars will increase. Hence the power drawn also increases. Where the torque is proportional to the current, I said that also increases. Right? In this way, it draws more power by increasing its torque to withstand the capacity of the load. In the same way, if you increase the load, the same phenomena will act. The speed starts reduces, hence the rate of flux cutting increases. Hence the current draw increases. Once the current draw increases, the torque produced by the motor also increases. What is the necessary of the torque? The torque is nothing but the force where it can draw the load, because I have to run with the load. So to run the load, I should require more force to drag up, to pull this load. So hence in this way, the rotor will pull the load. So this is your three-phase induction motor working and the total phenomena, nothing but how do it rotates, if load applies, how do we, it increases its torques. This is the total phenomenon of three-phase induction motor.